Hi, this is Mark Hopkins, and welcome back to another episode of Unsung, hoping to take your mind off the troubles of the world for the next 30 minutes or so. We're re-interviewing a guest that we had on, I guess, last year, who was running for office. He's a career law enforcement officer in the county. He's held several jobs. He decided to, the best use of his energy at his age, if I can say that, was to serve as a judge. Ran for office, got defeated in the election, and it was a shoo-in. I thought it was a shoo-in, but as politics has taught us recently, there's no such thing. Mike Altieri, thank you for coming back.
Oh yeah, thank you for having me.
Yeah, I wanted you to come back. I think 90% of my guests, I want to come back. I want you to come back because I think you got shafted. I watched you work so hard, and full disclosure, I don't know about your opponent other than what I've seen in the media, and I don't pay attention to that much. But I watched you work. I mean, I remember going to different things and going to calls and all, and I'd see you going down streets, walking door to door. And I just remember seeing, it was like you were everywhere for a period of time.
Yeah. I calculated I went over to over 3,000 houses throughout my whole campaign.
Did you do anything where you like had to phone or anything, log how many miles you went?
I was averaging about 5 miles a night walking.
And how many nights do you think you were out there?
Every day.
For how long?
Weekends, I'd go out about 11 in the morning until it got dark. And weekdays, I'd finish work at 4:30 and get dropped off somewhere and just walk until it got dark.
Yeah, I mean, you were out there. Your wife was behind you 110%. She'd drop you off somewhere, and then she rolls up, you know, like Alfred picking up Batman at the end of the day and takes you off, and then you do it again. And it was, and I know every day wasn't like that during your campaign, but it seems like whenever I saw you, it was like miserable weather.
I had some miserable days, but you just got to keep going and walking. And actually, I thought the days that were miserable, more people were friendly because they saw that, you know, you were very interested in what you were doing.
And it was a commitment, I guess, for you being there those days.
Oh, yeah. It's a commitment, like something I've never done.
And unfortunately, you told the story on the earlier episode where you have to go up to Harrisburg and you go to this thing where you, I guess, give a quick overview of the horrible process.
Yeah, you have to – your initial – certification, you have to go to Harrisburg for a month, and you have to complete basically a mini law course. And then at the end of that, you have to take a very stressful test, which is very difficult. And upon completion of that, if you want to maintain your certification, you got to go up every year until you get elected. And I started this process back in 2012 and just kept going back to Harrisburg, and after 2 years, you got to retake the test because your certification runs out. So I continued on the path, and fortunately, I was able to complete everything as required and take the next step in last year in campaign.
And maintain your regular job as a county law enforcement officer.
Yes, I had to take vacation. It's a lot of commitment.
And the and you're not home for your family during that time and
correct.
Other stuff, and it's a shame because you put that in and you know it doesn't roll over, and I understand to a degree why it doesn't roll over, but I just don't think we have so many good people that want to do that job that, you know, it just disappoints me whenever I see somebody who just you feel has the heart and the passion and wants to do the job and is the best person to do a job given their past experience and their track record.
Well, I've seen and learned that unfortunately some people are in politics, people are told to do different things where I chose to do that job. And unfortunately, I came up short, but you know, God has a plan for me and I'll just keep moving forward.
Well, it's amazing how it, in my dealings with politics and political things, it's amazing how at my age that it makes me feel innocent and naive to think that someone will say something and they're going to do what they say and say what they do and that's it. And that's not politics.
No.
That's not politics.
No, I've learned a lot. Unfortunately, it seems to me that if you're honest in politics, at least in my case, the two words don't mix because I stayed honest, I stayed true, I did nothing negative, and I'm not accusing my opponent of doing anything dishonest, I'm just saying. And you meet a lot of good people, there's a lot of supporters I had, and they were wonderful, and they stuck with me from day one.
But you didn't do any smear campaigns,
not
is what you're
one.
Saying, something like that. You just kept
not
the high
one.
Road. Is there anything you would do differently if you could go back and run again?
You know, it's hard to say because I really thought I was on a good path. And statistically, and from the primary, I was on a good path. It was just things that were said about me that were not true, that kind of derailed a couple things, I believe. I can't say, and the weather, I believe, was a factor. So it was an awful, cold, rainy day.
Yeah, the weather seemed to be a constant theme for when my glimpses were your things. It was like, you know, the weather was constantly fighting with you. And forcing you to prove your commitment again and again. And I just think that you had the qualifications. And this was the story of somebody on a 5-year journey. And then you just got – you guys coined a phrase earlier. You just got blindsided by, you know, describe that night of the election.
At the end of the night?
Well, the process leading up to it, you knew exactly how many votes you were up, down, up,
down.
Oh,
yeah, I was up.
In the cars.
I was up. As the day went on, you know, you're fighting to try to get the people to vote for you, and your supporters are showing up, and it's just, it's an awful, awful process. It's terrible. But you know, you have to do it. It's part of the game. But then after dinner time, I saw cars pulling up, 4 or 5 people getting out of the car, walking in and walking out. And I knew they were there for a purpose. But then again, I had, you know, my supporters were coming up, making it a point to say hello to me. And then at the end of the night when we were doing a count, you know, I was initially up and then I started dropping and then I was up and then I couldn't regain when I was down at the end of the night, and I couldn't regain the votes I needed.
And you took the high road, and you did everything right. And there are times in life where you can do everything right and have a negative outcome, and do everything wrong and have a positive outcome, and that's just part of randomness of the universe. And You're quietly optimistic, and I think that there's something that you would have gotten from this. You were telling me stories of all the encounters you had during the thing that were putting you in the right place. Tell me a couple of those stories.
Well, it started out when I was out and about in the neighborhood, and I saw a woman frantically looking for her dogs. And once again, my wife was in the area with her car. And when I heard her calling for her dogs, I asked her, because she didn't want to stop and talk. So I quickly asked her for her name, phone number, and a description of her dog. And sure enough, we got down the road, and I saw she described it as a black lab. And one 70-pound black lab come running out from behind the house. I grabbed it, told my wife to call her immediately, and then a second one came out. So I didn't know which one to grab, so I grabbed them both. So I'm wrestling with these two big dogs. Finally, I saw her car, and I thought they'd run to her car, and they ran and jumped in my wife's car. And they're jumping around the car, and apparently they're both her dogs. So that I was trying to get a picture, but things were happening so fast. She told me that she would think about voting for me, and then I guess when she thought about it, she sent me a text that night that she actually did, which I was very, I was happy about that. And another encounter I had was with a woman who, one of my pastors came out with me one night. And the very first house I go to, you never know what you're going to see. Being in law enforcement, you never know what you're going to see. Running for office, you never know what you're going to see.
Even more so?
More so.
Okay. Okay.
We went to a house. My pastor was driving. I walked up to a porch. This woman came out. I was talking to her briefly. She starts crying. She has problems. And she asked me what church I went to. I told her, and I says, there's my pastor right there. Well, he ends up getting out, going up on the porch, and they all start praying on the porch. So apparently there was some problems with these people, and I believe that they are going to attend our church. Another woman told me that her son, she was afraid he was going to commit suicide. So we helped her through that ordeal. So I definitely came across a lot of interesting people, and I was glad I was able to help them.
Despite the ultimate outcome, do you feel that you grew from the journey?
Oh, absolutely.
Would you do it again? If you were a younger man.
I don't know, because like I said, I try to do everything positive, non-smearing, and be honest all the way through. And it doesn't seem like you can do that and win an election.
It's like you might have picked the wrong job to,
or maybe the wrong time.
The wrong time. Yeah. The wrong time. Wrong time. It's like, one of our best guys on the SAR team for finding people, he doesn't like to look at the bodies of deceased people. And I said, well, you've made interesting choices, but yeah, I think you're right. It's the time, because I think that, one of the things you talked about was that people of one party, even in the area where their party was dominant, were a little hostile at times because of things that were going on that are well out of your control.
Yeah, I didn't understand that. I would talk to people, and I'm not trying to pick on any parties, just people in general were angry at just the whole political realm of the country. I didn't understand a lot of stuff, and I would try to explain to them, a judge is non-political. We have to be non-judgmental as far as a party or whatever, and even independents didn't want to hear it. I had doors slammed in my face. I've had people tell me they don't want to hear anything, and I didn't understand it. But
it's interesting, because when we were talking, as we often do before the show, I was rambling or babbling, I don't know which. And Russell said something, and I wrote it down here on the postage stamp that I write Russell's wisdom, words of wisdom on, which is not near full, is justice is law plus mercy, combination of law and mercy. And I think that's one of the best definitions I've heard. How do you feel about that?
Absolutely. You, as a district judge, you have the ability.